Good afternoon to all my dearest student friends. Today being the third day, I am going to discuss about the managerial unionism. After hearing this deliberation, it is expected that one will understand the introductory part of managerial unionism. One able to answer issues relating to the evolution of managerial unions that in India, and one will be able to address solutions to the questions raised for the purpose of boundaries of managerial associations, and one will understand also the managers' reactions to managerial associations and why managerial unionism is needed, and what are the activities of managerial unions. Apart from that, one will be able to take a good summary of managerial unionism. So to start with, let me give you a brief introduction regarding managerial unionism. So as we all know, in the organization, we have managers, we have officers in India, and that too, they are belonging to such diverse organizations. And when I say diverse organizations, starting from your manufacturing enterprises, through your commercial banks, through your insurance companies, we have also research and development laboratories, we have electricity boards. Apart from that also, we have trading corporations, merchant navy, also the civil service, lucrative civil service. They are all increasing, bonding themselves into collectivism, or you can say bonding themselves into collectivities of associations. And today, which are gaining the aspects of your trade unionism. So the word managers is not the only possible label for the diverse group of people. Rather, we can also talk about industry, because industry employs managers, the civil service, and you can also talk about the merchant navy, and they have their officers, as do the banks, they have their officers, the insurance companies, they have their officers. Maybe they're dealing with a specified area, so far as insurance are concerned. And apart from that also, we have research institutes and laboratories. They also do employ, not the officers, they do employ the scientists, the technologists. We have electricity board, the sections of also commercial pilots, airlines, they have the pilots, they are the engineers. Although all these people, they are called by different names, no doubt about it, but they are all doing varied jobs. So it is quite clear from the discussion that the men and the women, those who are working for these organizations, they have a great deal in common. And when I say they belong to the higher echelons of the organizational hierarchy, so far as reporting pattern is concerned, and there are different, they are very much different from your white collar groups. White collar groups, when I say, such as your clerical cadre, your clerks, your draftsman, your technicians, even in the sales line, your salesman, in the laboratory, you have laboratory assistants. They're all white collar groups. Those whose tasks are quite routine, no doubt about it. And the task, not only routine, they're also very much repetitive. and although non-manual, and the blue-collar employees who are paid for exertion of physical effort, mental effort, they may simply be titled as managers. But when I look at India, in India, your communities, or the organizations of managers, they are all popularly known as officers associations. So you have administrative officers association, you have bankers officers associations, you have insurance officers associations. So what I mean to say that the officers associations, as well as the trade union, they all exist. The very purpose is to protect, and the very purpose is to advance the work interest of their members, those who belong to the associations. And as such, the term association and the trade union can be used synonymously, like we are sometimes using in IT, the data and information. So after giving this introduction regarding manager unionism, it would be better to talk something about the evolution of managerial unions that do in India. So in India, no coherent chronological account is available so far as evolution of managerial unionism is concerned, much less its spread, much less its density. Because we have organizations and we have organizations of managers, they appear to have been in existence for decades, with the Association of Merchant Navy Officers, your Association of Airline Pilots, Association of Flight Engineers, dating back to the, I would say, period around independence. And when I look at the civil servants, obviously, they have similarly been organized for a long time. So Mam Lotam, way back in 1989, believes that the first impetus for this managerial unionization came from the workers' unions, with the first having been formed among the supervisors and promoted subsequently to the officers' rank, who had been over a period of time got accustomed to the unionizations. But with the phenomenal expansion that what we have noticed in the banking sector, that in insurance sector, and a massive investment in the public sector enterprises in the country, starting from during the 60s, what is being noticed that there was a spot in the number of managerial unions. That is why perhaps I would say there is almost no public sector enterprise today whose managers are not organized. So when we are talking of this, the managerial union movement that is reported to have grown over a period of time, reported to have been spread during the 70s, especially I would say in the coal, especially in the steel sector, especially in the petroleum sector, especially in your engineering sector, your chemicals, your textile, your economic, electronics, backed by the demand and supply, your banking, your insurance industries. So what I mean to say that the managerial unions, when we are talking of, like your trade union in general, suffered a minor setback towards the mid-70s. And do you know why did it happen? On account of national emergency, that is 1975 to 1977. But however, immediately after lifting of the national emergency, managerial unionism gained its momentum. So in fact, during the Janta government regime, and followed by your emergency, what was noticed that the several officers, associations, they were all registered as unions under the Trade Union Act 1928. And some of them were formally recognized by the top management of their respective organizations. So in 1978, the association of officers in the public sector, they noticed a major shift in their character and so a direction from a rather passive, non-assertive stature to an active style and going for assertive style. So that was a kind of change which was noticed, and many existing associations also merged during this period. And that is how the movement was consolidated, thereby consolidating the movement. This also led to the change in the relation and the relation between the association and the management. How to maintain good relation, healthy relation between the associations and the management, the top management, which became more, I would say, cordial in general. Though bitterness continued in several cases, so it's all case specific. So together with consolidation, many senior level managers also, they began to join these associations for the betterment of the managers. So in the public sector, the managerial union movement entered some kind of, I would say, new phase and in the 80s. So in the year 1983, to be more specific, the National Federation of Officers Association was formed, and mainly the purpose was to protect the interest of the officers in the central public sector undertaking, CPSU. And if we look back in the year 1983, witnessed another significant development in the managerial association movement. And in that particular year, 1983, also the Government of India asked all the central public sector units or undertakings that they were following the central DNS allowance pattern. So you have to switch over to the industrial DNS allowance pattern. So the officers association of one of the 89 central public sector units, when we are talking of CPSU, Central Public Sector Undertaking Units. So in that case, 89, the officers association of one out of 89 CPSU got affected. And when it is a question of being affected, got affected by the decision of the government and filed a case in the Supreme Court and against the government decisions. So the decision of the government regarding your change of DNS allowance pattern from the CDA to IDA, that is industrial DNS allowance, and filing of a suit was made against the other party in the Supreme Court, acted as a spur for the formation of the officers association, not only in all affected central public sector undertaking units, but also in many other organizations, the same was also noticed. So subsequently, way back in 1988, what is being observed that these officers association of 89 affected central public sector units, they, in fact, joined hands to form a kind of, you can say, a separate confederation of association of officers. And the purpose was to see that how does the economic policies and the industrial policies of the new government that came to power in June 1991, they have created pressures and they have created insecurities for all public sector employees, including the officers. So as such, as the role of the, when we are talking of national confederation, has become all the more important, because when this national confederation of association of officers were formed, they become all more important as well as challenging, because the very fact that we have to see that the officers, the managers of the giant corporation like Coal India, like Steel Authority of India Limited, ONGC, IOCL, Indian Oil Corporation Limited, and the power sector, even enterprises are not the members of the earlier federations, but they have come closer, no doubt about it, closer to the NCOA, but they have come closer to their respective industrial federation of officers, industrial federation of managers, or the industrial federation of executives after the introduction of new economic policy way back in 1991. So a major development that occurred in June 1992, in fact that was the formation of a new organization called the Professional Workers Trade Union Center. This Professional Workers Trade Union Center, the very purpose was to look after the interest of the managerial staff, the interest of the supervisory staff, the interest of the officers, the interest of the scientific officer workers all together. And among the major organizations that we are talking of, they have all joined together to form the Professional Workers Trade Union Centers. You talk about All India Bank Officers as confederations. You talk about your national confederation, your national confederation of Association of Officers, your NCOA. Or you talk about any other organizations like your All India Life Insurance Officers, your associations, Life India Officers Association, your National Confederation of General Insurance Corporation Officers, your Association and Council of your Scientific and Industrial Research Scientific Workers Associations. So these are the five organizations together. They represent roughly about 4.5 lakhs professionals, workers. And the most important objective of these, you can say, these professional workers trade union centers is security of service for the managerial staff, for the supervisory staff. So when we look at the development, we find that the development occurring in the managerial unions, in the public sector industries, and their impact on the private sector. So as a result, the private sector managers, both in MNCs and even if it is a family-controlled enterprises, have formed their own associations. So the industries in which managerial unions formed in the MNCs, they include your pharmaceutical industries or your heavy engineering services, chemical sector, or consumer products like your Glasgow or your Gaskin, William, or your General Electric, because among them, the indigenously owned companies which have officers' associations are your Grasim, your already I have told you regarding the Tata Electric, and Mafazlal Group, your Kamanis, etc. So if I estimate the number of managerial associations and their membership, even I would say in the mid-80s, if I go back, they are all about 200 and 3 lakhs respectively. So from this, you can well know that what is the phenomenal growth so far as the members are concerned, so far in terms of size. And the more intensify the, in fact, organized, the more intensely organized and public sector white collar undertakings like government departments or banks or the insurance. The State Bank Officers Association was estimated to be about 50,000 strong. So after this, it is high time to talk about the boundaries of managerial association, because many a times what is being seen, the problematic, it is problematic, I would say, because to determine the limits of the, you can say, association constituencies of managerial association in India, so that no association should encroach upon the liberty or the limit of other associations. So there's a person known as Ramaswamy, way back in 1985, describes the boundaries of managerial association, and that too with a caveat, that means be aware of that his descriptions presents only a general picture. And the general picture of the boundaries of a typical managerial association, and as such, we have seen vast differences to exist in the, do exist, no doubt about it, in the managerial association boundaries, and that too in different organizations or even in different enterprises within the same industry. So if I add Ramaswamy, according to Ramaswamy, maybe at the base of their managerial association, took up from where white collar, clerical, and staff unions they stop. So that is the starting point for the officers' associations. So at the apex, you have managerial decisions, which would evidently leave out the top layers of managers who may not join, may not be also acceptable to the association. But one silver lining difference is that the what lies in between those two points when we are talking of association theory, which is based on your base and which is based on your, you can say, many times what we have seen that the development is taking place, but the fact remains that the most intensively organized at the public sector white collar undertakings like your government, like your other departments, like your banks, like your insurance. So, keeping that in view, when we are making discussion regarding the boundaries of managerial associations, so according to Ramaswamy, at the base, the managerial association they take up from where white collar, as I told you, clerical and the staff unions they enter. In the process, at the apex, you have managerial associations, and which would evidently leave out the top layers. And when I say top layer of managers who may not join, who may be acceptable to the association, who knows that? So why then this? So then what lies in between your two points is that is your association theory. Apex, in the apex, the where the top layers of the manager personnel are left, base, white, clerical, your staff unions, they will come in that particular bracket. So here, in this case, if we return our attention to the differences in the boundaries of the managerial associations, then in that case, in different organizations and that too in different districts, you try to manage through somebody, may not be that is eye-catching, but to make some kind of beginning, it will be good, because in some commercial banks and association, commercial bank associations, or you may say the members normally, what they do, they stop at the regional manager, because regional manager happens to be the middle management positions, and the other officers of the level of the assistant or deputy or general managers would normally keep out. They will not be included for the very purpose. So in the life insurance corporations, the membership extends a little further with the general managers also joining the association, and the steel plants, that is normally functional in our country, and the coal mines probably representing the climate. So having said all these things, it is with the association membership, and with the association of membership, how do you reach out maybe at the particular level of general managers, so you fit into the exact level. So after that, it is high time to talk about something regarding management's reaction, something regarding managerial associates. So to start with the management's factors, the management reactions, how do they respond to the need, how do they respond to officers, management, how do they respond to the managers. Association in public sector have been varied over a period of time. So you have different types of managers, you have different types of executives. So the initial response in almost all cases was one of the antagonism. Antagonism means you are going against. So apart from that, also the hostility, and this hostility is resulting either dismissal, or there will be transfer of activities, and which will continue the mid-70s. So, however, having said that, in the late 70s, one thing that is to be seen, that in the past emergency period, however, there is a change, which is normally in the attitude. It is seen, it is demonstrated in the attitude of the management, and that is very much evident, because these are all towards attitude of the management towards the managerial associations. And in all, most cases, what we are observing, these associations, one thing we find, these are all accepted as something to be tolerated. So in that case, you are making some kind of compromise. So the earlier hostility gave way to new relationship. And this is really new relationship based on your mixture of your trade and mixture of your love, mixture of your hate. So as the management started dealing with the managerial associations, So they discovered that the association of officers or other association of managers, because all of them could not see. So the fact remains that this is an evil force, and as such, many of them gave a de facto recognition to these association and working, developing a kind of working relationship with which got established the even when the establishment was made between management and your you can say managerial associations. So the more the demand, the more will be the activities in terms of your official order. So the fact remains that we have to see that the organizations, what they are doing, and as such, many of them gave de facto recognition to these associations, and as a working relationship, they got established between the management and the managerial associations. So a few enlightened employers, they said no innovation should be there, as a result of which we have to see that they gave some kind of formal recognition to their officers, they gave some kind of formal recognition to their managers. So managers association, officers associations, they are contacted, they are well informed. So in that case, we have got several examples of like Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, HAL, Steel Authority of India Limited, your SAIL, your BEL, your IOCA, everything. So now question arises that why we are more concerned about managerial unionism? Why managerial unionism? If it is not there, what will be the kind of harm to the company? So some of the major causes of the formation of the managerial union in India, they are narrowing wage differentials. And when it is a question of narrowing wage differential, there is a widespread, I would say, feeling among the managers when that compared to unionized cadre of workmen, they are getting a raw deal from their employers and the deal in terms of remuneration. So they complain. They complain about the narrowing differentials between the emoluments of junior officers and the wages of senior workmen. So why there should be disparity and why there should be a gap? So this feeling of relative deprivation, or this is a feeling of you're going for comparison, which has in fact contributed significantly, I would say, to the emergence of your managerial unionism. Because you know that the managers, they hope, what do they hope? They hope that collectively they can exert pressure on the management, pressure to give them a comparable salary, like whenever worker wages are raised, so corresponding their wages also is very much required to be raised. Another thing which is there, so far as a cause for the formation of managerial unionism, that is the loss of identity. Like workers, managers too experience a loss of power, and as a result of which you lose your face, your facelessness among the changes, among the reorganization, I would say, reorganization of the enterprises in the modern world. So many managers, especially these junior managers, one have little access to information and information pertaining to the company. Another cause for the could be the cause for the formation of the managerial union is if that is your job's security, which is very, very important, because while one of the hardest things in Indian industry, that is to terminate the services of your workers. So it is not very difficult that to remove the managers from their job, no. Even in the public sector undertaking. But the junior level managers or the middle level managers, what they do, normally they don't have the job security. But we have Industrial Dispute Act, we have Industrial Dispute Act 1947, where you will find that the workmen enjoy job security. And they are also entitled. They are very much entitled to layoff compensation. People are being laid off, asked to go. So obviously they need to be compensated, if at all laid off. Similarly, you have retrenchment compensation, if at all retrenched. So apart from that also, you have some sort of statutory compensation in case of establishment is closed down and its ownership got transferred. So managerial or the employees are not entitled to such security and not entitled to such you can say benefits. So if a workman, if he is terminated from the service, if a workman is suspended, in fact, or if a workman is retrenched, then his dispute connected to this issue will be treated as industrial dispute. So on the other hand, if the service of a managerial employee is terminated, it cannot raise an industrial dispute. So job security point of view, this will come. So therefore, one of the major causes for the formation of managerial unions, that is your job security. Similarly, you can also look at the perceived need for protection from militant trade unionism. You have managers at the junior level, you have managers at the middle level. What they are responsible for, they are very much responsible for your translation. And when you say translation, managerial decisions into actions. That means your implementation, putting into practice. So they are in the direct line. They are in the direct line of union fire. So if you have unionized workmen, if you have unionized staff, they could make it difficult for the managers to take work from them due to their union support, because it is their responsibility to give protection, the protection they enjoy from the labor legislation. And because of this, the managers are uncertain as to how to go about with the unionized labor. If the young managers, they decide to charge it an offender, then in that case, his boss may drop the charge. And do you know what would be the ground? Ground on the ground of expediency. That means due to the pressure of the unions. So you have laxity on his part. And the laxity on his part might, on the other hand, evoke some kind of comment. He is not sufficiently firm. But as such, the middle-end managers, when we come across, they seem convenience that they cannot count on support from above with regard to the unions. Because in most of the cases, when they have acted in good faith towards the organization, if there was a failure because of the tremendous pressure coming from the union side. And apart from that also, another cause could be your bureaucratic culture. The bureaucratic culture, when we are talking of, that normally characterizes the working environment of all public enterprises. That is also another factor contributing to the emergence of managerial unionism. So what is happening in these organizations? In these organizations, you have junior level managers. In these organizations, you have middle level managers. So what they do, they feel they are lost as the decisions are taken unilaterally by their higher authorities. Or the decisions are taken unilaterally by their concerned ministries. So what I mean to say that it is to make their presence felt and to have some say in the decision-making process in matters which are affecting them, matters affecting them that managers and officers are organizing and forming their association, that is the result. In addition to that also, your absence of participative forum, because government and the management, they are very much concerned with the workers. And when they are concerned with the workers' participation and workers' participation, that should come in the management. And in all these cases, hardly that will give a thought to the manager's need to participate in management. And as such, when we look at the junior managers, when you look at the middle managers, they feel that very much they are faceless. They are very much a kind of voiceless entity. And that is not the unionized workers, but themselves. So these managers, what they do, they draw the lesson and they need some kind of organized association, and that organizes, they need some kind of organization or they need some kind of association only to focus the attention on their problems. And that is why they use the collective negotiation or they use the collective bargaining for the entire process to take place between their association and the top management as a participative forum for being associated with the management as closely as far as possible. So similarly also the promotion policies, that is also another cause for your managerial unionism, because promotion policies of the organization have had their effect on association formation, because the nationalized bank, if you look at, they have to fill by promotion 3 to 4 months of the position at the lowest point in the officer category. And the most of the organizations, they promote employees from the rank to the managerial cadre, maybe as a matter of personnel policy, as a matter of personnel promotional policies, even though there is no explicit compulsion. So another common practice normally seen is to attach the problem of stagnation through a change of designation while letting the job, keeping the job itself unchanged, keeping the job itself intact. So these promoting officers, they have often been in the forefront of association formation, because these employees find it difficult to reconcile to the loss of power they have experienced as union activities or members or whatever it may be. Another crucial cause could also be to be the third force between the working class and the management class. So being denied the protection that normally we are talking of, protection of labor laws, protection of privileges of a real managers, that is why the junior and the middle managers, they have gone for the only one option to them, that is left to them, that is formation of the officers association. So they would not like to be considered as part of your, you can say, parcel of either the working class or it may so happen the management, but as the third force between these two groups. Now, after making discussion what could be the causes of your managerial unionism, so let us discuss about the activities of managerial unions. So when we look at the activities, we find one thing that being denied in most of the cases, the activities of the managerial associations, they reflect the character of the managerial unionism. They reflect the personality of the managerial unionisms. So the day-to-day activities of the managerial activities may be categorized. One is protection or preservation or some kind of improvement. The second category would be so far as occupation, so far as interest, so far as welfare activities are concerned. And the third aspect would be your organizational interest and the channel of communications. So also in this case, it would be appropriate to mention protection, preservation, or your improvement of occupational interest. So the main thrust of the managerial association is on protection. The main thrust of managerial association is on preservation, the preservation of your movement, of the occupational interest of their members. And this will include your other things, some kind of opportunities and for the purpose of promotion and for the purpose of pay revision, for the purpose of grievance redressal, grievance handling, or for the purpose of improving working conditions and your introduction of the enhancement of various fringe benefits can also be taken into consideration. So while pursuing the occupational interest, some associations, they resort to agitational methods, such as it could be your taken as a strike or demonstration, making a row, not allowing to go outside the campus, the organization, or the workplace, or displaying posters in relay and objectionable language, which cannot position in the street, cannot be shown, because these are all prone to litigations. Similarly, the another cause could be your welfare activities, because in case of welfare activities, one thing that is to be seen that the welfare activities of the managerial association in general, that will include your establishment of cooperative societies, that will include your management of cooperative societies, your management of officers club, management of officers canteen, your organization of cultural activities, organization of your recreational activities, organization of your cultural activities, everything, because the fact means that starting from the cultural, recreational, sports activities, all things can be included in the welfare activities. Apart from the management of your educational trust, your collection of certain amount as a part of your managerial association subscription, And they are looking at financing the same for a group insurance scheme, so that the life of individual managers, employees, workers are secured. Or you can take some scheme of life insurance corporations, which can also further track to the situations. So another cause of the when we are discussing the cause of formation of the managerial unionisms. Now, since we are discussing the activities of managerial union, so in that case, your organizational interest can also be taken as one. Because the when you are talking of the activities of a managerial union, so obviously organizational interest cannot be ruled out. This is one of the important activities of your managerial association, that is to supplement the efforts of the management, which are aimed at the professional, which are aimed at your development of managers. And all these things are possible by way of organizing seminar. All these things are possible by way of organizing some kind of discussion, professional discussions. And because when you do this, then that is going to supplement the efforts of the management, which are very much aimed at professional development of the managers. So by way of organizing seminar or by way of organizing some kind of extramural lecture, talks on various topics. So another important activity is to help the management in improving the productivity of the organization, because finally, what we look at how the productivity of the organization can be enhanced. So in addition to that also, we have channel of communication. That is also another activity, because in most of the cases, what is being observed that managerial associations are providing to be an effective channel of communication in their respective establishment, respective field, in the respective, you can say, establishment, by raising the concern of the officers before the management, or by presenting the views of the management to the officers, or the managerial association operating like a bridge, the two-way communication between these two. So when we make discussion like this, one able to, after hearing this, one will be able to outline the evolution of managerial unions in India. Since your attempt to give a general picture of the boundaries of a typical management association can also be provided. And one can briefly describe the management reaction to the managerial association. One will be able to deliver on that. And one can also examine the causes of the formation of the, you can say, managerial unions. And the person who is the student who is hearing this deliberation can also give a brief account of the activities involved in the managerial association in general, not in any association in particular. And you have categories of activities, no doubt about it, of the managerial unions. And there is also improvement of occupational, you can say, going for occupational therapy should be some kind of improvement over the existing practices. So categories of activities of the managerial, starting from the protection through preservation, through your bringing some kind of improvement of the occupational interest of the members, looking after the welfare activities, and obviously that should be the interest of the organization to which you serve. And the channel of communication, because Today, the channel of communication is more important in the sense that in most of the cases, unless we try to ventilate the very purpose for which the things are being changed, the other side will not be able to understand. So that is the case why we always talk about that the managers and the officers that in India, when they belong to diverse organizations, so starting from the manufacturing enterprises through commercial banks, through insurance companies, research and development, laboratories, merchant, starting with the merchant navy, civil servant, everybody. So they're all increasing what? They're increasing their bonds by themselves into collectivities of associations, and which are all gaining trade union unionisms. So the word, that is why when you are using the word manager, when we are using this very word as managers, this is not only possible label for the diverse group of people, because managers, they are very much engaged in the industry. Industry employs managers. Industry employs civil servant, civil service, your merchant navy officers. As do the banks, they have their officers. Insurance companies, they have their officers. Research institutes, they have their laboratories which are employing scientists, which are employing your technologists. Similarly, you have electricity boards, you have section of commercial airlines, they have their pilots, engineers. They are all called in different names. You cannot have a single name which will be applicable for different types of setup, organization, or the industries. So that is why you cannot merge these managers and officers with the workers, because it is quite clear that these men and the women, they have a great deal in common, no doubt about it. They belong to higher segment of organizational hierarchy. They are different from the white collar groups, because when I say white collar groups, obviously they are your clerks, they are your draftsmen, they are your technicians, they are your laboratory assistants, whose tasks are quite routine, whose tasks are very much repetitive. And although they do non-manual work, but the same thing doesn't happen in case of blue-collar employees, because blue-collar employees, they are all paid remuneration for the exertion of the physical effort they put. They may be simply be titled as managers. Because in most of the cases, what we have observed, that after in India, they look for collectivities of managers, they look for organization of managers, which are popularly known as officers association. And the officers association, as well as your trade union, they exist. Why do they exist? They exist to protect, they exist to advance the work interest of their members. So as such, the term association and the term trade union can be used synonymously. So after hearing this session, one would be able to explain the evolution of managerial unions in India. One will be able to explain the boundaries of managerial association. One will be able to deliberate on the management's reaction to managerial associations, apart from the activities of managerial unions. And question would arise, if one will be able to explain all these things, then you will have a thorough knowledge so far as managerial unionism is concerned. With these student friends, I come to an end of this session. Again, we'll meet tomorrow at 1:30 p.m. Thank you very much. Have a nice time. Good day.